First, she inquired about growing the beard and whether it is sunnah or mandatory. Yeah, growing the beard is definitely a wajib or a mandatory practice. That is because once there is a command, whether in the Quran or by Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, this command indicates that it is compulsory, unless if there is any indication that waives the mandate from being compulsory to simply being recommended. Is there any example to both? Oh, of course. So when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam orders anything, then that thing which is ordered is absolutely wajib. Take for instance, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, with regards to performing ghusl on Friday, it is compulsory on every muhtalim. So the obvious meaning indicates that it is compulsory. But once it is kept, then here the command indicates it is recommended, highly recommended. And what is the difference between a wajib and a sunnah, compulsory and prophetic tradition or liked or recommended act? The difference is very vast. For whatever is categorized as a sunnah, if you do it, you will be rewarded for it. If you choose not to do it, there is no punishment whatsoever. Simply, you will be deprived from the reward. So when you do it, it is for your own good. But if you don't do it, you lost the reward and you did not earn any sin. You did not incur any curse or any sin. Like any supererogatory prayers. When this Bedouin came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and asked him about what is mandated with regards to the prayer, he said 5 daily prayers. Illa an tatawwa. Unless if you want to pray extra. So extra. You name it, whether before dhuhr, after maghrib, after isha, before fajr, even the 2 sunnah before fajr. It's highly recommended, but it's not mandatory though. And according to the vast majority of the scholars, the witr prayer, it is an emphatic sunnah. Only according to Imam Abu Hanifa, it is wajib. So the sunnah, if you do it, you'll be rewarded. If you don't do it, you will miss the reward, but there is no punishment. This is not the case with the compulsory or mandatory acts, wajibat. Wajibat, compulsory, that if you do it, you'll be rewarded. If you don't do it, you'll be punished. Because this is a divine command. Some people differentiate. We say, but that is in the Quran and this is only in the Sunnah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was given the same authority of the Quran to mandate things, even if it is not mentioned in the Quran, which will make it compulsory. Hadith of Abdullah ibn Abbas and others. فَرَضَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ صَدَقَةَ الْفِطْرِ صَاعًا مِنْ تَمْرٍ أَوْ صَاعًا مِنْ شَعِيرٍ أَوْ صَاعًا مِنْ زَبِيبٍ. The hadith is a sound hadith. What does it say? It says that the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, ordained. He made it compulsory. He made it fard, obligatory upon every Muslim who fasted during the month of Ramadan to give sadaqatul fitr. Whether he fasted or not, obviously, but I'm talking about every Muslim. Okay, so every family guardian is required to give sadaqatul fitr on behalf of himself and those who are under his guardianship. What if he didn't do it? He's blameworthy. He didn't pay zakah, but it's not mentioned in the Quran. It doesn't have to be mentioned in the Quran. In ayah number 23 of Surah An-Nisa, chapter number 4, Allah the Almighty listed the categories of those who, of women whom you're not allowed to marry or to take for marriage forever. That's why he began by saying hurrimat, have been made unlawful for you to marry your mothers, your sisters, your daughters, your niece, and so on. Okay, but would Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, have the same power of forbidding or mandating? Of course. That's why it is not included in the ayah. That the ayah says وَأَن تَجْمَعُوا بَيْنَ الْأُخْتَيْنِ إِلَّا مَا قَدْ سَلَفْ, which means it is not permissible to marry to two sisters simultaneously. Okay, in Islam this is not permissible. But Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, added to that, and it's not permissible to marry a girl and her aunt, whether maternal or paternal. Even though it's not in the Quran, but it has the same power like the Quran exactly. I can give you many, many examples. This is just to refute this misconception of some people who say it's just a sunnah. Why? Because it was the Prophet who commanded it. Well, once it is commanded, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam put emphasis that it is wajib, then it must be done. Once he said it is forbidden, then it must be avoided. Sometimes the prohibition is not for the hurmah. It doesn't mean that it is haram. Rather, it simply means that it is disliked. Give you two examples. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam forbade drinking while standing. But once he drank while standing before the companions, what does it mean? It means that he reduced the hukm from mere prohibition to dislikeness. So it is better to drink while sitting, to eat while sitting. But, you know, occasionally if you have to drink while standing, it is permissible. But he did not allow drinking with the left hand while being able to use your right hand. You see the difference between haram and dislike, between wajib and sunnah or recommended. Where does growing the beard fit? Where does it fit? It fits in the category of a wajib. And this is a view of, you know, the vast majority of the scholars. Why? Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam commanded in many sound ahadith, saving the beards for men. He said, save the beard and trim the mustache. And he said in some ahadith that it's not only prescribed in Islam, rather it is among the traditions of the pure natures from the time of Ibrahim alayhi salam, all the way the believers practice these practices, including growing the beards. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and all his companions, they had saved their beards and they trimmed their mustaches. So what do we understand? We understand it's a must. When somebody says, but we have a scholar who is shaved clean, okay, is this an indication that if you see a scholar smoking weed, does it make it lawful? Does it make it halal? No. Rather, we should object to him and say, you've done something wrong, and you're more worthy to follow the Prophet and his guidance, not to do otherwise. So if you're asking, what is the ruling in growing the beard for men? It is wajib, according to the vast majority of the scholars.